but just like a little odd, I guess.
Oh yeah, it's a white lie that's dumb.
Yeah, and as mentioned, the reason that the clerk let him check in without ID, I guess, you know, again, small town, they're a little more lenient. So she did let him check in without ID, but she said that she let him check in without ID because he seemed like a nice guy. Seemed like an okay guy.
What a normal dude.
Yeah, and then, you know, a couple hours later, she was describing him as kind of off and making her uncomfortable, so I don't really know. She said that she thought that he might have had a slight Canadian accent, but I also think that that could mean a lot of different things. Again, especially since it's such a small place and it is more north, it's so totally possible that she just, you know, any accent sounded kind of Canadian to her, you know?
Well, there's a whole host of accents that if you're not really paying attention and they're very subtle, people can incorrectly apply them to another nationality.
He probably just mispronounced a word or two, and she thought, well, that's so close to Canada there, you're going to get lots of Canadians there. And she probably just thought, oh, maybe a Canadian. By mispronouncing, I'm not saying Canadians mispronounced, but they say things like, you know, a boat instead of about, and things like that, you know.
After that first day, the next day...
Which was a Friday, did we say that?
No, we didn't.
Friday 14th.
It was a Friday, yeah.
Okay.
That it was a pretty uneventful day. I've seen reports that Lyle was seen pacing up and down the highway, but I think that...
By the side of the highway.
The side of the highway, but I actually think that that's a misunderstanding of what actually was happening, which was that hotel staff reported that he was seen walking up and down hallways in the motel area.
There's no hallways, Devin. They're little bungalows.
You could call it a hallway between things.
Okay, I would not call that a hallway, but I also think that if he was walking into the town, the only way to get to town is to walk down the side of the highway, so I think that's where that came from.
I read an interview that we'll talk about a little later with the woman who's the daughter of the maid that found Lyle, and she had, one of the things she said is that she had seen him pacing up and down the hallway, is what she called it. So I don't know.
I mean, he might have been doing both. I mean, he had all kinds of time.
That's true.
True.
I mean, the guy had no reading material in his room.
Well, he did.
He had newspapers.
He had the newspapers.
Yeah, but I mean, other than that, though, I mean, and, you know, I mean, he was pacing up and down beside the highway. Maybe he was waiting for the bus.
Yeah.
You know, or something like that.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
On the 16th, again, not really totally clear what happened. There are some discrepancies in reporting. His body was found on the 17th. They believe he hung himself either really late on the night of the 16th or maybe really early the 17th, but probably Sunday night.
Yeah, it's hard to say. Depending on who is telling this in written form on the internet, it can make it very, very confusing. When I first read your stuff, I was like, "That the days are totally off," because I had just gotten finished reading one that I realized had totally bungled the time frame.
Yeah, it's a kind of weird time frame because I think people want to truncate it a lot because there's no information on those 2 days between.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
People are just like, he checked in and then he died, but there's two days in there.
He must have done something. Man. Yeah, one of the things I haven't seen anything about is, what did he do for food the entire time? Did anybody check the local store to see if he went in and bought, like, donuts and milk?
Or see, that's why I was thinking that he was walking
cafe?
Into town.
Yeah. Well, one of the things somebody brought up, which I think is actually probably a pretty good theory, is there was a barber in town, and maybe he went in for a haircut and a shave, because he was clean-shaven, mm-hmm. and his hair was...
But he had no razor.
And he had no razor.
Yeah, but he had no razor. Again, this is a little cart before the horse. So, as I mentioned, you may have missed it, he did ultimately end up hanging himself. Mm-hmm. Was his method of suicide. He had hung himself with his belt and there was a green washcloth between his neck and the belt. There are some not safe for life photos on the internet. They're super easy to find. And the thing that's very weird about these photos is they are like disturbingly not disturbing to look at.
Not,
did you guys
not,
look at
they're
them?
Very, yeah, they're kind of placid is the term I would use. He looks
placid.
Yeah,
they're very calm.
No, they're not.
There's
grisly
no
or
violence.
Gross. No.
It's just, and you know, it's I don't know, maybe it's something with the tone of the pictures, like the actual color. Oh, that's interesting. Not like, oh God, that's a dead human hanging there. But it is a dead human hanging there.
Yeah, that's the whole thing. It's like there's this guy lying there, and then you realize, oh, the poor guy's dead. Oh, that sucks.
Yeah.
He just looks like sleeping, like kind of like that Mary Anderson.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
She just looked like she was sleeping. So, as mentioned, he hung himself with his belt. There was that washcloth in between the belt and
the green
neck,
washcloth.
The green washcloth. The buckle was facing his chin, and he tied the other end of the belt around the metal pole. And then they call it an alcove in the motel room. It's the closet.
It's like a closet with no doors. And the metal pole is one of those metal racks that you see in hotels that you're supposed to set your suitcase on.
But it's above head height.
Yeah, this one is higher than you normally see them in a hotel.
Well, I've seen this before. So what you're thinking of is those little foldable ones that you would set your suitcase on, I think. No, I've seen this kind before, and they're usually at about eye level so that they can be used with the hanger shirts and stuff like that. But then it's also got the platform on top, and they intend for you to put your bag up there rather than the little foldy one. But I've seen these a whole bunch.
Yeah, they also sometimes store extra pillows and stuff like that up there.
Or the iron, if they provide an iron.
Yeah.
They always provide an iron, Steve.
If they provide an iron.
They always provide an iron.
I always make them take it away. I can only hurt myself with this thing. I can do no good.
Yeah, so he was not hanging off the ground. He was kind of in a kneeling.
He was very committed to this act.
He was, yeah. And he was facing the back of the wall, so he was facing into the alcove. His head was tilted up towards the sky or towards the ceiling, and he had hung pillows on either side of the little alcove that he was in, presumably to avoid making noise.
Because you automatically are going to thrash when you're...
He really did not look like he thrashed.
I mean,
he probably did. I mean, just knowing human
nature. Yeah, I think that it didn't look like it because he hung pillows and they absorbed the blows.
But,
maybe. It doesn't look to me like he did either, because what he did is by hanging... He stuffed the pillows between...
The sides
of that metal thing in the wall. Just stuffed them in there very tightly and nicely. And if he'd thrashed, I would think they would have been knocked askew a little bit, but they're perfectly aligned with each other. And so, who knows? It doesn't really matter, I guess.
But the fact is, if he did thrash,
nobody heard him anyway.
The weird thing, though, is that because that shelf was so low, his knees were barely off the ground.
Oh, yeah.
That's why I say that he was so very committed to doing what he was doing.
He could have very easily just stood up.
Yeah.
Or even, like...
Turned.
Literally... Almost any movement would have probably stopped the process for him. So I think that's one of the things that does strike a lot of people about this case is that he.
There's a lot of things about it. I mean, like,
there's a lot of
for
things.
Example, like you say, he was, like you said, he was clean shaven.
Yeah.
You're gonna kill yourself. Why bother shaving?
He was clean shaven, but he didn't have a razor.
But why bother going to the barber to get a shave?
I don't know.
It's weird. There's a lot of weird things about this.
Yeah.
Pacing by the highway.
Yeah.
Makes me wonder.
So, since he was recently deceased, it was easy to get his fingerprints, his dental records, and his DNA. The DNA, I will say, I know is saliva DNA, so they can't send it for a lot of the DNA testing that they would otherwise be able to send it for. For science reasons. I don't understand the science behind it, but there's science reasons.
There's not enough sample there, I think it is.
Yeah, but I think they have some way. It doesn't matter. Anyway... They can't do the the
mitochondrial DNA.
Maybe that's the one where they can trace the family tree.
Uh huh. Mitochondrial.
Yeah, they can't do that one.
They can't. Why not?
Because I don't know.
Saliva. They don't think they get enough.
Reason. But I thought they did because that's how you did it when it's like the 23andMe. When you send in your DNA for your genetic analysis. So I don't really understand. Why I have just seen from the people who have been really, really committed to this case online, reading through their kind of conversations, seeing that, yes, we wanted to send it, but, the saliva DNA, for whatever reason, the saliva DNA we have, we need something to test it against. We can't just go look. Anyway.
Well, that's another thing that makes me wonder about this one, is why nobody's just done a general test to see what his ethnicity is.
Well, so that one's
so
a bit...
There's question about it.
That is actually a bit of a thing, yeah. I don't know. I don't think that there is... actual lack of consensus. I think that the actual investigators are pretty agreed on what his ethnicity is.
Mm. It's the internet that is.
But it's the internet who's just like, well, I don't know, he looks kind of like he might be this. Which is true. I mean, he does look, you could kind of just put him in a lot of different ethnicities.
He could be Hispanic, he could be American Indian, he could be Arab. There's or a lot. Persian. Yeah. He looks like a lot of different
yeah,
things.
Yeah, we'll talk yeah. about all of that. A full isotope report is available online. It's 29 pages long.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about some of that a little bit, but we're not going to go too far into that. So if that's the sort of thing that does interest you, you should look at that.
It's got maps and everything.
Super easy to find. But I want to keep talking about Lyle's the room yeah. and all of that stuff. Lyle was found by the maid. She knocked on the door to try to clean the room. Yeah. And she said that when she went in the first time, she thought he was praying in the alcove. She just kind of saw his like knees and saw him, you know.
She does what every maid does when they open the room and they see that somebody is there and probably doing something that they don't want to be observed doing.
And she went,
she simply yep. closes the door quietly yep. and yeah. goes on about her business.
Yeah.
She probably thought autoerotic, that thing. Yeah. Uh-huh.
No, okay. I think she yeah. probably just like saw his feet and was like, okay, whoops. Sorry, you know, sorry, sir. And, you know, I'll come back later. Later, she came back with a manager, and they called the cops when they realized what had happened.
And, yeah, the manager's the one that went in and realized what was
yeah.
going on.
Yeah, he had left $160 exactly in $20 bills and a note saying, for the room. Because you remember, he'd only paid for that first night. $160 happens to be exactly what he owed for the other two nights.
It looks like, I've heard it said on the interwebs, that they were very crisp, brand new $20 bills.
They looked pretty crisp.
And they looked in the picture, they looked pretty crisp.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's what I want to know. Are they truly, authentically, you know, really super new, crisp $20 bills?
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that, Joe. I'm sorry.
Damn it.
I know. It's crazy. Those are the sort of things that would be, like, really nice to know, but yeah. I don't think people really ask that question a lot. He had eight additional dollar bills crumpled in his pocket and a pen. There was some change. I can't remember how much exactly.
Like $1.75 or something.
I think actually $1.75, something.
Yeah.
In, like, loose change, like dimes and nickels yeah. and stuff like that.
And by the way, in the picture that you see that there, the coins have been like arranged, they've been sorted out. And that was and did you say that was done by one of the policemen?
Yeah.
To count them? Okay.
Yeah, what I said was there's in some of the pictures you can also see a little piece of paper with columns and like tally marks that, you know, look like, oh, somebody was tallying up how much money they had. It was the detective.
Somebody literally was tallying
yeah,
up how much
it really
money
was.
Had.
It wasn't some weird thing that was left in the room, it was just the investigators were counting the change.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how they were keeping track of it. Because it was like it was kind of a lot of change. It wasn't, I don't know how many quarters, I don't remember, I'm so sorry.
It didn't look like more than a couple of quarters.
Yeah, but most of it was like dimes and nickels, I feel.
But if you're one of those people who automatically pulls bills out to pay for stuff and doesn't try to use up
well,
your
it
change,
was like that.
It yeah. very quickly adds up.
Totally, yeah. But it was more that like it wasn't as though you could just be like, well, there's five quarters, so it's, you know,
yeah.
$25.
No. Yeah, it was a mix.
It yeah. was a bunch of, yeah, a lot of nickels in there.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's pretty sweet that he still paid his bill.
That was nice.
And kind of speaks to his character, probably.
Maybe.
The only other things, as mentioned in the room, that didn't really belong there were the toothbrush and toothpaste. There was also an empty Pepsi cup and two copies of the Sunday newspaper, the local Sunday newspaper, from the day before.
Yeah, the Daily World from Aberdeen.
Yeah.
Yeah, I called them, and they don't have an online archive.
Huh.
I wanted to see what that issue covered. Probably 9/11.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Since it was right after, less than
yeah.
a week
of
after
course.
9/11.
Yeah. But one of the copies of the Sunday paper was in the trash with the Pepsi cup.
Yeah.
And a crumpled piece of paper that just said suicide on it. And the other copy was out. So I don't know why he had two copies, but there you go.
Probably got it out of the machine, and you can always take more than one if you want.
Yeah.
It's the honor system.
True. But he seemed like a pretty honest guy. I mean, he left money for the hotel room, so... Anyway.
Maybe he was going to commit originally suicide by newspaper and change his mind instead
oh, yeah.
of using salt instead.
By just paper cuts or something.
Yeah, yeah.
He had spoken to the maid on Sunday night, just before his suicide, and he had made it clear that he did not need cleaning services, but he did ask for a fresh towel, and he also handed the trash out to her in the hall.
He arrived on Friday.
Yeah.
He hung out on Saturday.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
His body was found on Sunday.
Monday.
Okay.
Yeah. Monday.
That's, again, I know people.
Yeah, there's the 2 days that are like unaccounted for.
Always messes me up because people, when I see the reporting, it's so truncated. Okay,
probably killed himself Sunday night. But
okay.
And now, and
he killed himself Sunday night. He was found Monday.
Yeah. Okay.
And again, back to the maid's daughter who posts stuff on that Facebook page devoted to this. You know what I'm talking about?
I do. Yeah.
Apparently, it was during this exchange that she says her mother heard another voice in the room.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that.
Okay. Sorry, I keep stepping all over you.
That's okay. No, it's fine. There's a bit of intrigue there. It's a to be continued.
Yeah.
She did say that, but I'm not sure. But she did take the trash out that night, so that was new trash as of Sunday evening.
Mm.
Just, you know, again, if that means anything to anyone. Lyle, you know, since he hadn't given an ID or anything like that, but you do have to give an address, a home address for your hotel room stay. So he gave the address of 1019 South Progress Avenue in Meridian, Ohio.
Idaho.
I like Ohio better.
Right next door to each other, practically.
Yeah. So the local investigator... Sorry, did you have something to say?
Oh, about... If you look at the note, too, he actually didn't put Meridian, Idaho. Somebody else wrote that in.
Meridian, Idaho?
Yeah. If you look at the where he wrote it down, it's not his handwriting.
We can talk about the handwriting
in
a little bit. His handwriting's not consistent, but the suspicion is that it's because he was faking his handwriting.
Could have been.
I mean, he wrote in those big block letters,
uh-huh.
which is, like, totally in line with what people do when they're trying to mask their handwriting.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, we can talk about that in a little bit. The local investigators did, of course, reach out to police in Meridian. They said, hey, we found a body. The guy said, this is his address. Can you go check it out? And it turned out that it was either a Ramada Inn or a Holiday Inn. Depending on the reporting, I didn't bother to Google it. I'm sorry.
I have a feeling it's probably hotels change names.
Yeah.
They change hands.
It looks like your standard, you know, Days Inn, Ramada Inn kind of place, you know, kind of, you know.
Yeah.
A little better than a scuzzy motel, but not exactly, you know, the Hyatt Regency either.
Totally.
You know, sort of in between.
Yeah, the Hyatt Regency.
Not as upscale as La Quinta.
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah.
Well, that's right up kind of on a par.
You know.
There goes advertising for La Quinta.
Yeah.
So the investigators had sent over some photos of Lyle to the police in Meridian, and, you know, the police in Meridian showed it to the staff at the hotel there, and they didn't recognize him at all.
Mm.
Which either means, you know, he never stayed there or something else entirely, which, you know.
I think they kind of like... kind of fell down. I mean, right across the street, there's like a Home Depot and a Walmart. You probably should have walked over there and showed his picture around too. Saying, you know, does this guy shop here? Does he work here?
Yeah.
They didn't do that, as far as I know.
I think that's probably true.
They probably should have.
I don't know if they fell down on the job, Joe. I mean, that's you saying, oh, I see this thing. I think it's interesting.
Well,
they should do that, where their job is go to this place, ask these questions. I have a whole bunch of other stuff to do besides this cold case from another town
that I don't
have any involvement with.
That's the thing. Is that, of course, obviously nobody at the time knew that this was going to turn into a big obsession for a bunch of people on the internet. Nobody knew that at the time. Just one of those things, like, in retrospect, it would have been kind of cool if they checked out this and this and this, you know, but nobody knew.
And again, this is a week after 9/11.
Yeah.
Most of this country was not operating on all cylinders. Most people were still operating in kind of a fog.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So, a physical description of Lyle is he was measured, quote unquote, measured at 6 foot tall. Most of the reporting you will see says that he was anywhere between 5'10 and 6'2. I don't totally understand. Like, they had his body. Like,
I just
totally understand why you wouldn't know how tall a human was from their laying down position. But
that's okay. I see where if you have a body that's several years old, where you know it's maybe shriveled a bit, and you can't really tell for sure.
Or there's some trauma that's been done to
things
it,
like that, or if it's in pieces. Well, yeah, I get it.
Man.
But yeah, they had a complete body. I don't get it either.
The investigator said that he thought that Lyle was 25, but the official age range given is 20 to 30. He had straight black hair that, as mentioned, was neatly trimmed and little to no stubble. I've seen some discrepancy on this as well. I've seen either he had zero stubble, definitely no stubble at all, But I've also seen that he had maybe a day's worth of stubble. Like, I mean, you know, for a lot of guys, especially at the mid-20 range, like, a day's growth isn't really much to sneeze at.
But he did definitely have a stubble.
Yeah. Okay. No,
he did not.
He didn't have a full-on stubble. He didn't have what you and I would call 5 o'clock shadow.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. He didn't have that. He might have had a little bit of hair there, but it wasn't anything outstanding.
It was, you know, the same way that a teenager grows a beard.
Yeah.
the wispy mustache.
Yeah. But again, as mentioned, we're going to keep saying it's a little weird because there was no razor in his room. But he was in that room for 3 days, so his eyes were hazel. As mentioned, his ethnicity is on the internet up for grabs. He's officially listed as white. There's that speculation that, you know, he's Hispanic, Native American, Mesoamerican, Middle Eastern, Italian, or even from Norway.
I'm not sure about the Norwegian one. The only connection I can find in Norway is I went to Google Maps and typed in Stivik.
There's
a Stivik, Norway.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the only reason I can think.
Yes. That is why people think that. Officially, like I said, he is listed as white. There has been some official investigation into Native American communities as well. I presume since they have his DNA, they've done some kind of genetic marker test.
That's
of
hard
some
to
kind.
Say, though, because they keep saying they can't do certain tests because they only have the saliva DNA.
Yeah.
So, I don't understand that. You got a whole friggin' body to work with. You got all kinds of bodily fluids.
I don't think they have
a
body
they
anymore.
They didn't take it until after the fact. I don't think they really pursued the whole what is his ethnicity until he was in the ground.
But I thought they took tissue samples and blood samples and all kinds of stuff from his body to save just for later purposes.
I thought they would have done that as well, but like I said, I've read. But I get, you know, again, it's all internet reporting, so it could be totally wrong. Mm-hmm. But since it's an ongoing investigation still, like, we don't probably have all the information that we could use, you know?
Yeah.
I do believe that there is some Native American connection, but I think he's, you know, like white/Native American.
It's
super distant.
Yeah.
So he also had some semi-distinguishing features, like his nose.
Yeah, so it did look like it may have been broken. The ME's report didn't mention that it had signs of actually being broken, and so I actually think that it's a distortion from him hanging himself that happened on his nose instead of it actually having been broken. Like, not recently, but it was like a broken and healed situation. Because usually there's scars and stuff, but I don't know. Again, he also had attached earlobes, which is apparently like a thing that only 16% of the population has, and it's like genetic. So again, that should be
something that will help
another little thing to help narrow it down, but it seems to not really be working.
Nothing worked with this guy.
He had, they just call them marks on his knuckles.
Kind of like contusions.
Officially, they're like Russell's signs, which are calluses on your knuckles, most often associated with long-term bulimia. And we'll talk about that in a little bit.
That comes up in the series. I'll leave that till then.
Thank you. He had perfect or near-perfect teeth with signs, the kind of perfect teeth you get only from orthodontia, not like nobody's ever born with teeth like that. Yeah. He also had a quote-unquote not recent appendectomy scar.
Yeah, it wasn't pink still.
Yeah, I mean, you know, at least a couple years old.
Yeah.
I think faded. He was wearing a blue plaid shirt, a genuine leather brown belt with a big silver buckle while he was...
Genuine leather.
He was wearing it in the wrong spot, but... and the buckle was kind of a big Western buckle.
Was it a Western style buckle?
I was going to ask about that. It looked like the kind that I have,
loop,
which is just a metal loop.
Yeah.
I think that is the Western style buckle.
Oh, see, when I think of Western like style, I think of the big old rodeo
oval,
cowboy.
Yeah, the
kind
oval
of.
Shaped one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
That's why I was asking about the style.
That's
okay.
What I was thinking too.
Just like a not European style.
What's the European style?
The
thin and narrow.
No, I think of those as those square ones that are like a panel, and they have like the hook in the back,
the
and it just clicks in.
Yeah.
That's what I think of. I don't know.
Okay.
I could be totally 100% making that up.
Yeah. So that's what I've got.
Yeah.
And then Steve's got the loop.
This is the weirdest episode ever. We're all pulling our belts out.
Well, you guys
look
are.
At what I'm wearing.
Look,
yeah.
At, look, at, here.
Look at my belly
yeah.
button.
But, oh. Yeah, okay. So it was a loop. Okay. It was a loop type buckle.
It's my understanding that the belt showed signs of significant weight loss.
Which makes sense on some things that we'll talk about later.
Again, yeah.
And that he had changed holes.
Yeah, that there was significant wear on like two different holes that weren't just right next to each other.
That or he got the belt secondhand, but hey.
Yeah.
Well, the Emmy said, and granted, all of the clothes that he was wearing were like, his pants were like a little baggy on him. The Emmy said that he showed signs of having lost about 40 pounds recently.
Maybe. Or the... yeah, I mean, he was wearing a size 36 jeans, and, mm-hmm. and the guy was 6'2", mm-hmm. weighed 140 pounds, which mm-hmm. is pretty damn skinny, and mm-hmm. I can't see fitting into a size 36 jeans. That's more like a, what, 32 waist?
Well, know? I had 140 pounds.
At 140 pounds?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's like, yeah, so and they would have been really baggy on him.
Yeah. Which is why he had a belt.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, got the belt. Although,
yeah, no, thinking about how much I weigh and what I wear, that is super balloon pants.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But at the same time, he might have just bought them at a local Goodwill somewhere in Port Angeles and, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Emmy had evidence other than just the baggy pants to suggest that he had lost the 40 pounds.
Maybe he had loose
recently.
Skin
it's my understanding, yeah, I think there was some, like, loose skin situation happening. So he was wearing blue jeans, as mentioned, and then he had black leather Timberland boots, which were in like pretty good condition. The jeans were Levi's, the boots were Timberland. You know, it's kind of like nicer, but not luxury brand
yeah,
stuff.
Not Calvin Klein.
Timberland boots are pretty dang expensive, though, or can be.
I actually looked into this a little bit, trying to figure it out. And Timberland, the company, got bought by somebody several times and began to add apparel other than boots to their catalog in the mid to late 90s. And then they started adding more apparel in the mid 2000s. And that's really, I think, when their cost started escalating. So I don't think they were super expensive at this time. I think that they were mid-grade in terms of cost. They weren't low end, but they definitely weren't what you would see now when you see the, you know, some guy on stage at a show performing and he's paid $1,000 for these Timberlands. They weren't at that level.
I mean, they were like
$1,000 boots.
I'm sure that they will bedazzle them with diamonds for you and sell them to you for as much as they can.
I think Timberlands were like a good $150 or so at least,
but
in
not
2001.
Super high priced. Yeah,
that's not
cheap.
Cheap,
I mean,
but that doesn't mean that he bought the high end boot. Also, remember that everybody makes an expensive model and a cheap model.
Yeah,
and there's going to be a range there.
Yeah. Anyway, at some point he had also taken a bedspread and put it up over the window to block out the light.
Or noise.
Yeah. As we mentioned earlier, there's that full isotope review that kind of maps his movements.
Such.
Where he could have been.
Where
yeah.
he could have been.
I.
From things like minerals and stuff in his skin and hair, which
and
is
teeth.
Like creepy and useful and
Can I step on a soapbox about this thing for a second?
Yeah.
Because it bugs the heck out of me because we talked about some kind of isotope review in, what was the Princess Doe? We talked about that, and they had actually been able to narrow it down to very specific sites. In this, there's nothing very specific. I mean, when you read this report and you start looking at the maps, it looks like if you were watching the national news and Al Roker or Willard Scott were on there showing you the temperature bands across the country, that's how specific this map is. It's like, this band reaches from the East Coast to the West Coast and does this kind of serpentine curve. And that's as specific as...
Well, what's interesting is that if you look at and they map it by different minerals and stuff.
Yeah.
And so if you look at the differences between it, you can see space, you can see that there are certain places that are a lot more specific.
But it doesn't pin anything down, that's my problem with
well,
it. People freak
have,
out. People
have,
go to town on this thing.
Well, I have a big problem with this methodology, too. Which is that it only maps basically North America. essentially, and it should be mapping the entire world. I mean, they're assuming the guy comes from North America. The guy might have lived in Asia or Africa, God knows where, his entire life, and only come here recently. And so it makes it look like, wow, he came from this narrow sort of geographical area in North America, but there's, you know, I don't think that's at all proven.
Yeah.
I would agree with that. The one thing I will say is that it's my understanding from that isotope review that it looks like he spent some time in Amanda Park, like a couple months before he killed himself, and then went away and then returned.
And that's the other thing is like, you know, how could that be? So maybe this thing isn't that trustworthy after all.
Well, I mean, it could be.
He came in and like hid out in somebody's trailer for a couple of months.
Maybe he was staying with somebody and that person.
He was in witness protection.
This is a theories thing, right? But, you know, maybe he was staying with somebody and that person died and he left and then came back to kill himself because that was the last person that he cared about. And those would have been the two people that knew him, you know, like there are reasons we can like theorize, just speculate wildly around why he could have been unidentified in the area. Yeah, irresponsibly. I just have two more quick notes before we get into theories.
All right.
One is what we mentioned already with Joe, just kind of like giving us that nugget of of the idea that Lyle may not have been alone on Sunday night in his room. The speculation coupled with him not allowing the maid to come in to clean Sunday night, the maid saying that she thought that she heard maybe other voices in the room, and the fact that from the crime scene photos, the toilet seat is down. Let me finish.
Makes both seats are down? I mean, the ring.
Yeah, both seats. Again, makes people believe that that means that he was not alone, that he had a female visitor that night.
Yeah, actually, that's true, that no man ever shuts the toilet seat.
That's not true.
No real man does that.
No.
Yeah.
That's absolutely not true, you Neanderthal. Listen, toilets are gross, and there's no reason that I need to be staring into that thing, because I don't like to, and it's unsanitary.
Okay,
so
okay.
Should be closed.
I was tweaking Steve.
Because
Steve
you
does
monster.
Close the toilet seat. Yeah. Okay.
But I mean, like, that's part of it, too, is that Lyle strikes me as a very clean person
general. It's not unheard of for somebody to, you know, actually
close both seats.
Not totally, but at the same time, it is not typical for a guy to do that.
I don't know.
You know what? That's not true. That it all depends on your personality and how you were raised. You know, there's this whole thing. Every man stands when he pees, but that's not true. There's a chunk of society.
I know. It's a good point.
So,
but every man does stand to wipe after they've pooped.
They do.
You should Google that.
No, I shouldn't.
They actually stand totally erect and wipe?
Yeah.
That's
every man?
There's a lot of discussion on the internet about, like, this was a thing that I had no idea, but apparently.
Suddenly I'm questioning my masculinity.
That there are a lot of people who, like, stand up to wipe.
What a bunch of monsters.
I know, I agree.
I had no idea. I've been doing it wrong all this time.
I don't know. I'm sure we're going to get some really great emails from people who are like, you're the barbarian.
Let me guess, and you also go from back to front.
Anyway, so we've gotten a little off track here, what should otherwise be a very serious episode. I think it's silly to use the closed toilet seat as evidence that someone else was there. I also think it's a little silly to use his refusal to have the maid come in to clean the room as evidence that someone else was there.
I've caught the maid at the door before and said, no, I'm fine. Okay, here's the trash bag. Like, just take off.
Exactly,
I'm hanging out. I don't want you in my room.
Exactly.
It's awkward.
I don't need my bed made, and I can reuse towels I took a shower with this morning. So, what do I need you in here for? Yeah.
Well, and I mean, there's also some speculation. Again, we'll get to this in a little bit, but that he had rehearsed his suicide because the technique that he used encouraged people to rehearse it.
Yeah.
And so it's possible he had it all set up already. And he was like, obviously, I'm not going to invite the maid in here to like see what's going on in here. So again,
she might critique my form.
No.
You know, I spent a lot of time on that suicide forum. And
Yeah. So I don't really know about that, but you will see that around. And I think that's as far as we're going to go into it. The other note that I will just briefly mention is that, as we said in the beginning, there is a character in a book called You Must Remember This, named Lyle Stevick. It's spelled differently.
The last name is.
Yeah, the last name is. It's spelled with a CK instead of just a K. But this book is like a super depressing book.
It opens with an attempted suicide.
Lyle Stevick, yeah. And Lyle in this book tries to commit, or like at least contemplates committing suicide a number of times. And there's this weird relationship between his daughter and his half-brother, who's a famous boxer. And it's just this, it's a really depressing thing. And so if somebody had read that book and was just looking for a pseudonym, picking that one makes some sense.
Yeah. That's a hell of a coincidence, though.
It would be, yeah.
I mean, it is and it isn't. I mean, we all have our favorite books, you know, and maybe it just happens that this was Lyle's favorite book.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll let that go.
It's, you know, actually, it's possible. The guy, I like, took an English lit class in community college. Or something like that, and they read that book. You know, maybe.
See, I was like, no, nobody's going to let me sign in to a hotel using my favorite book character's name because they know that I'm not Curious George.
I know. They know you.
You're not
Captain Kirk.
I don't have enough hair.
Yeah. Anyway, that's my last note.
Okay.
Do you guys have any other notes that you want to add before we...
soon.